It's not about anything else we can do, but it's about your grace, your mercy, and your love. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right. Will you stand and worship with us? We sing about the God who's forever. You may be seated.
We're getting ready to celebrate communion together. So if you have not yet done so, then you can go to the back of the room if you're here in person and pick up your communion. When you get it, you can see that there's a real thin layer on top that you can peel back and get to the bread. And then you can peel back the next layer, the foil layer, and get to the grape juice, symbolizing the body and the blood of Christ. And we'll take that together in a minute, as Christ has instructed us all to do. In one of the old Batman movies, the Joker says several times through the movies, "Have I told you how I got these scars?" And then he makes up a crazy story about each time. Well, I have a scar, a physical scar, that has kind of a strange story to it. When I was about 6 or 7 years old, I was complaining a little bit of a sore throat, nothing bad on a Saturday night. But when I woke up Sunday morning, I was really struggling to breathe. I tried to call out to my mom. She couldn't hear me. I couldn't get enough breath to make much of a sound. So I ended up, literally crawling into her bedroom where she was getting ready for church. My dad had already left for church. He's a pastor as well, and was already there for first service, and we were still getting ready. My mom didn't know what was going on or what to do, so she put me in the bathroom for a little while and turned on all the water as hot as it could go to thought I was maybe congested and the steam would clear me out. But soon she realized that wasn't really helping either, so she calls our family doctor, Dr. Adams, who happened to live just a few doors down from us. He rushed right down and took one look at me and took my mom and me, put us in the car, and drove us to the hospital. I was really still struggling to breathe. Doctor told my mom to, keep poking me and nudging me and make sure I stay awake. As last thing I remember, I'm in Dr. Adams' arms. He's carrying me through the emergency room doors, and that's all I remember. And my mom says, about that time, I just went limp in his arms. So the next thing I remember, I'm waking up on the operating table. I've got several surgeons or doctors with surgical masks standing around me, and one of them is Dr. Adams, and he says to me, "Hey, you want to see something neat?" And he reaches into my neck and pulls out a little black chunk of something. I didn't know what it was. He says, "Well, that's a light bulb. That's what we were using to see inside your neck." So what had happened was I had a disease called epiglottitis, which usually is just kind of a sore throat, but in this particular case, it took a virus attacked my epiglottis, which is the little flap that closes over your windpipe when you are swallowing so that food doesn't go into your lungs. But a virus attacked that and it swelled and was swelling shut. And so as looking back, we can see if mom had left me in the bathroom for a couple more minutes, I probably wouldn't have made it to the hospital. If we would have hit an extra red light or two, probably wouldn't have made it. So many things. Dr. Adams had already left for church. He went to our church as well. Probably wouldn't have made it. So all these different things, and literally came down to just seconds to spare. And so I can literally say that Dr. Adams saved my life. Years later, I was at my first preaching ministry in a little town in Sadieville, Kentucky, a little bit north of, kind of between Lexington and Cincinnati, and I heard a knock on the door, which was a little bit strange, to our parsonage there, and Dr. Adams and his wife were standing there. And I welcomed him in, and we chatted for a while, and I said, "Hey, I've got something I want to give you. I've kind of been going through my library and thought maybe you could use these." And he brought me a really nice set of commentaries that he had used as a Sunday school teacher earlier on. He said, "I thought maybe you'd like these." And, I thanked him, and we chatted for a little while. And they were on vacation and just happened to swing by and give me that extra gift. And I often think about that time. Savior, Dr. Evans, and I had an opportunity that not everybody gets to have, and that is I got to shake the hand of my Savior and say, thank you for saving my life. You know, I was married at that point. I had my first child on the way when he came by, and you know, it was just really a neat thing for me as a young adult to say thank you for, you know, all the years that you have helped me to have, because you were there at the right time and you knew what to do. So we all have a Savior. You know, we all have a Savior, and that Savior has his scars too. You know, my scar is on my neck from the tracheotomy that I had. Still see it just a little bit down here. But our Savior has scars that he took in his hands, in his feet, and in the side, in his effort to save us. And when nobody else could, he did so. So I always think about communion time when I think about Dr. Adams, because this is our time to say thank you to our Savior, to remember what he did for us, to remember how different our lives are because of what Jesus has done for us. And so when we take this communion, it's our time to say thank you to the Savior who made our eternal life possible. And so we take the bread, and that represents his body. We take that together, and we take the grape juice, which represents his blood, and it's the full picture of his sacrifice. And we do this to remember him, because that's what he's asked us to do. And as our Savior, he deserves to be remembered.
Thank you.
glory and honor to your name, for you are good and holy and mighty, and you have such an amazing love for us that you sent your only Son to die on the cross so that we could be with you someday. What an amazing, amazing love that you have for us. Undeserved, and we are unworthy. We want to just thank you this morning and every day of our lives for that amazing love. Help Bobby as he brings the message today, and that we can be inspired by the life of Joseph and know that we just need to keep doing what's right, even when it's not going right, because you loved us and you died for us. We love you so much, Lord. In your heavenly, precious, wonderful name, amen.
All right, I am thankful for our band and all the volunteers that work so hard each week getting everything set up. You guys thankful for everything they do? It takes a lot of time and energy, but man, they do it so well. They do it with a love for Jesus and a love for you guys. And so I'd love to hear us all sing praise and for everybody at home joining in and worshiping together. Let me invite you now to connect. That's something we talk about a lot here at Movement, because as we say all the time, it's not just about what we do here on Sunday morning. It's about going a little bit deeper, getting more involved, and being family here with the church. And so if you're here with us for the first time, stop by the welcome table on your way out. Fill out a connect card there at the welcome table. And if you're online, simply send us a private message there on Facebook. We'd love to get to know you better and find out how we can help you get connected. We have connect groups that meet throughout the week. We have one that meets in person, and we have several other options that are on Zoom. And hopefully, maybe in the next few months, we'll be going more in person, that type of thing. But we'll try to continue to have some sort of Zoom option forever, because it's a really handy thing in a lot of ways. So that's a really awesome opportunity. But another way you can connect with us deeper is next Sunday. We're rescheduling our campfire worship that's supposed to have happened a couple different times, but wet weather has really stopped us. We're planning next Sunday night, I believe that's March 14th, at 6 p.m. That's a time change, because guess what? The time changes that day. And if all God's people said,
amen.
Man, I'm excited. Y'all might not be excited about longer days, but I'm excited. So anyway, 6 p.m. for the time change for that day for the campfire worship. That's going to be a really cool thing for those that maybe haven't been able to be with us in person indoors. That'll be a great opportunity to come and worship with us outdoors together. It's going to be in the home of Steve and Jen White. Also, when we think about our time of generosity, I'm excited about the opportunities that God is placing in front of us right now. You know, if you've been around us for a little bit, you know we've been praying about God opening a door for a more permanent home for Movement, and He is still working behind the scenes. We've got a letter that we are working up to send to our entire church family that hopefully will be going out in the next week or so, just sharing what it looks like for us to do this and do ministry well the way we've always done it, and really help change our communities here in this area for Jesus Christ. And so be on the lookout for those letters that will be mailed to you, and talking about how you can help partner more with Movement and seeing the gospel spread to this world, not just right here next door, but all around the world. And on that note, we want you to pay attention on your way out. If you hadn't already seen it, the missions table has actually moved locations. It's over here. There's a lot of stuff about our missions to Ireland, because this is the month that we celebrate St. Patrick's Day, right? And so it's a perfect little fit. So stop by there on your way there. We have an event coming up at just a couple of days after St. Patrick's Day. That's a fun thing you can do outdoors with your family. It's a little scavenger hunt, and the proceeds to that will go to the missions we serve in Ireland, Swain's family that's there in Ireland. And also, there's some masks that have been made, and all the proceeds to those go to our missions as well. And so there's some really nice masks. There's three different prints. And there's also a regular adult size. There's an extra large for people that have a big face like me. And then also there's kid sizes. So you can understand, Leonard? You got that?
Yes, I've got a big face.
I got a big face too. That's all right. Big face brothers. That's right. So, but that's something you can stop by at the missions table as well. And all those proceeds go to missions supporting here at Movement. And so when we give online, and when we give in person, when we give here at Movement, it makes an eternal impact. It makes a kingdom impact. And so you can give at the offering box here in person. You can give on movementchristianchurch.com, and you can give on our church app if you have that downloaded. So when we give here, it changes the world. And that may just sound like something you say, but it's so true. I see lives every day that are being changed. So thank you for your generosity. We're continuing our series here as we're looking at the life of Joseph. And today, I've sort of alluded, if you've been paying attention or you've been watching online, you've been seeing what's going on, I've been talking about the different stories that we've sort of hopped over. Now we're going to talk about a really key turning point in Joseph's life. And have you ever noticed that a big theme in movies is revenge? You ever notice that? A lot of movies have a revenge thing to them, especially if it's like an action movie or some kind of drama. Maybe even comedies kind of sneak it in, because unfortunately, most of us struggle with wanting to get revenge. A movie that my family really likes, because it's something that the whole family can get into and you don't have to worry too much about it, is a movie called The Princess Bride. Has anybody ever seen that? Everybody seen that movie? It's a really funny movie. It's good. It's, like I said, it's something for kind of all ages. But the whole theme of that movie is a guy trying to get revenge with, first, a woman who he thinks has turned her back on him, and then ultimately the guy who has betrayed him and taken her away from him. And it comes down to an end where he wants to have that revenge, and then also there's another guy who's trying to get revenge, and he's looking for it. Does anybody remember?
Six-finger man,
that's right. And he gets a revenge that he, you know, it's not biblical revenge, I guess. But the main character, he ultimately decides that the best revenge is kind of just living life the best he can and goes forward. And so it's a really neat story. But I have to tell you this, the best story of revenge that I know of is actually a true story. It's a true story. And many of you have heard this, so bear with me, but there are some people that haven't heard, but many years ago, a little over 20 plus years ago, my wife and I were dating, and she dumped me on my birthday. I know it's a dead horse that I'm beating, but that's what the gift she gave me as a preacher was to do something like that, and I can tell it. She dumped me on my birthday when we were dating. But here, that's not the revenge. The revenge came a little over 2 years later, almost. 2 years later, is I then proposed to her on my birthday for spite. For spite. I loved her. I loved her so much, and it was sincere, but I proposed on my birthday just so I could say, ha, I'm the bigger person. I'm the bigger person. And that's not even the revenge. The revenge is that she said yes, and she's been stuck with me now for almost 21 years. Yay! Joke's on you. I know I'm not right. I know I'm not right. I need Jesus every day. But what greater revenge is that she's stuck with me for the rest of her life, you know, or the rest of mine. I'm going to say that. But anyway. But here's the thing. Most of us, when we get hurt, whether it be on a small way or a big way, is we automatically want revenge, don't we? You know, it's kind of natural. We want revenge. We want to get even. And Joseph, if you've been reading along or you've heard these stories before, you've been paying attention to what we've been talking about, if anybody had a case for revenge or had the reason for a desire for revenge, do you think Joseph could raise his hand? Absolutely. Joseph had every reason to, his own brothers were going to kill him, and then they decided, well, we won't make any money off of that, and so they just sold him into slavery, which is not very good. And time again, he had people that promised him one thing but didn't fulfill it, and so there's another opportunity where he could want revenge. And beginning in verse 42 of chapter 42, you see Joseph's life has really turned for the better for the first string of years that we see recorded in Scripture. It seemed like every time things were starting to go well, something else would happen, and somebody else would do them wrong. But here we've got a long string of time where life is just really kind of going well. And he's the second in command over all of Egypt. Only Pharaoh is above him, and you could almost debate that maybe he was sort of above Pharaoh. Pharaoh looked at him as a father in some ways. And then, like a Hollywood movie, his enemies, which unfortunately were his brothers, are delivered, dropped right into his lap. They're dropped right. You couldn't have written a better script. And all I could think of is the office when Michael Scott comes in after he started Michael Scott Paper Company, and he comes in and he wants to say, "Oh, how the tables have turned," and he says, "Oh, how the turntables." And then he doesn't know what else to say. And that was kind of the awkward feeling that, you know, they were supposed to get. So good, way to play along, way to play along. But he said, "Oh, how the turntables." And you think, man, here they are, they drop right in my lap. I'm basically junior king. I'm the vice president, if you will, of all of Egypt. And now they're here, I can destroy them. I can torture them. I can do whatever I want. And Joseph may have thought about every single one of those things. He may have been plotting throughout his life what he would do if he ever got an opportunity to be with his brothers again. And the famine that he had warned Pharaoh about as he interpreted Pharaoh's dream had taken place, and that's what led his brothers right there to be dropped in his lap. They came to beg Egypt for food because Joseph had set up such a great plan and protected the people of Egypt. You couldn't ask for more poetic justice, could you? A guy who'd been done wrong time and time and time again, and now he's finally in a place to make it right. It had been years. And you've probably all heard the saying that revenge is a dish best served cold. You know, you let it sit there and it festers, and man, just when they don't even, the person who wronged you doesn't even think about it anymore, man, then you can get revenge. And this was going to be the case, it looked like, for Joseph. And it seems like in his first couple of encounters with his brother, starting here in chapter 42, that maybe Joseph might exact his revenge on them. In the first visit, Benjamin, his full brother, who was even yet younger than him, didn't come along. And he called the brothers spies. He said, "You're spies. You came here to just see what we've got and take advantage of us Egyptians." And he heard his brother Reuben saying that they were probably being punished for what they did to Joseph. And he may have been thinking, "Oh, you just don't know yet. You know, you don't know exactly what was completely going on in his mind." And then as he gets ready to send them back home, he says, "I'm going to keep one brother," and he kept Simeon here, "I'm going to keep him locked up." And he told them to bring back his full brother, Benjamin, later on. And then to top it off, the money that they brought to buy grain, he put back in the mouths of their sacks filled with grain and sends him home. So when they find it, they are terrified. They're like, "Oh my goodness, what in the world?" I mean, they're going to say, "We stole this grain," and they're just hard. They're having a difficult time with it. And they tell their father they need to bring their brother back, and he's like, "There's no way. I've already lost one son." He doesn't know how he lost that son, but he says, "I've already lost one. I'm not going to lose another. And now you've got Simeon, who's as good as dead too, who's left behind there in Egypt." But they finally get hungry enough, and so the second visit takes place, and they bring Benjamin along because the father, Jacob, doesn't have any really other option. So he brings Jacob along, and as they have a big feast there, and he's weeping in secret because of this time that he gets to be with his family and see his brother. And this time again, he returns their money again, puts it back in the sack. But this time, what looks like could be some revenge, he takes a silver cup or chalice, his own royal chalice, and puts it in the bag of Benjamin. And then he chases them down when they get a little bit down the road, and he says, "Ha, you stole my cup." And so they all come back, and it looks like everything is going to fall right into what you and I might plan, right? It's a great time. He could even destroy, he could kill them all if he wanted. And he threatened to arrest Benjamin, but Judah pleads for his life. And he basically says, "Take my life. Don't allow my father to be destroyed by the death of yet another son." He says his life is tied to Benjamin's life, and my father will die. And Joseph, whether he had been realizing it all along or not, Joseph ultimately sees that they are different men, and that they don't only think about themselves, and they're willing to sacrifice for a brother. He sees they're different men now. And so we pick up in Genesis 45. Genesis 45, beginning in verse 1. It says, "Then Joseph could not control himself before all these who stood by him. He cried, 'Make everyone go out from me.' So no one stayed with him when Joseph made himself known to his brothers. And he wept aloud so that the Egyptians heard it from the outside. And the household of Pharaoh heard it.
And Joseph said to his brothers, I am Joseph. I am Joseph. And Joseph, is my father still alive? But his brothers could not answer him, for they were dismayed at his presence. That could be one of the biggest understatements of Scripture. I mean, you're talking about terrified? You're talking about terrified? Another movie that has a revenge plot that ultimately he tries to do the right thing is a movie called The Count of Monte Cristo, based on the old novel. If you have never seen that movie, it's a really good movie. You should check it out. But when he reveals himself as the guy who was betrayed and sold into slavery and prison, basically, I mean, people's faces are just, they can't believe it. And it's like they literally have seen a ghost. And that's what these brothers were like. They were terrified because they'd seen their brother. They knew, like we talked about last week, that their sin had found them out, right? Have you ever had the opportunity to kind of say gotcha to somebody and seen that look on their face? You know, have you ever been gotcha yourself? And somebody is like, oh, you thought you got away with this, but boom, you know, you lay it down. And, you know, you lay it down and you say, I gotcha. Well, Joseph had this opportunity. And you know the temptation of just laying the smack down was right there in his brain because he was a human being. And Joseph was probably wrestling with that, maybe even down to the moment to bring the hammer down on the person who hurt you. But Joseph doesn't do it. He doesn't do it. Why? Why doesn't Joseph do what most of us would want to do? I believe it's because Joseph realized that God takes our troubles and turns them into a testimony. God takes our troubles and he turns them into a testimony. I love how the song said that earlier. Did you catch the idea of our testimony that God will make, and he'll make it true and he'll make it right? If you look at verse 4, it says, so Joseph said to his brothers, come near to me, please. And they came near, and he said, I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into slavery in Egypt. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in these land these 2 years, and there are yet 5 years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. And God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to keep alive for you many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. Man, I love that phrase, and I like talking about it a lot because, I mean, life seems bleak at times, and it seems like there's no hope, and it seems like everything is against you, and it seems like it's all falling apart, but God. And he said, but God sent me. He has made me a father to Pharaoh and lord of all his house and ruler over all the land of Egypt. God used Joseph's pain, the pain his brothers had caused him, to make him a powerful testimony of God's power. And if you're like most people, when you start talking about revenge and forgiveness, or unforgiveness for that matter, and pain and betrayal, chances are you're probably not really thinking a whole lot about Joseph's pain. You're probably thinking about your own. Even if you sit here or watch at home and you've forgiven somebody, maybe you've had to say it 100 times over. Even though you may have forgiven, the pain may still be there, right? And when we talk about betrayal and unforgiveness or people not deserving forgiveness, I guarantee you that a person or a group of people popped in your mind. It might have been the jerks who excluded you in middle school and you still think about them. Or it might be a family member, a spouse, a loved one, a boss, an employee, and it might be any number of people, but they come into your brain and you're like, I just don't know why they had to treat me that way. I don't know what I did wrong to deserve to be stabbed in the back to be lied about, to have that knife twisted in my back, to be left alone, to be neglected, to be made fun of, to be laughed at. You fill in the blank, and you already are. I don't know why they did it to me. And I don't believe beyond a shadow of a doubt that God caused those things, because sin causes pain and heartache and death. But God can take those sinful acts that people do and transform them, your troubles, into a testimony. And it's like he could almost be laughing at the plans of people as they try to destroy your life and say, oh, you thought you did something there. Wait till you see what I'm going to do with it if I just have enough time, if you allow me enough time. I'm going to make your trouble into a testimony. I'm going to make your time of pain into a time of the truth of God's power. Through those efforts of his brothers to try to destroy him, God saved most of the known world there at that time from a famine because of putting Joseph there in Egypt in that early time. And in the same world lived his hateful brothers who did such horrible things to him. And I want you to know, I want you to understand, I want you to hear it, is that God will do more than we ever could imagine to help people see his love and his grace if we practice grace and forgiveness. It may seem impossible. It may seem like there's absolutely no way. You just don't know, Bobby, what I've been through. You don't know what they did to me. But the truth is that God gives us the power to bless people. God gives us the power to bless people. If we'll trust him and we'll forgive and we'll lay things at his feet, God gives us the power to bless people. Look at verse 9 there. It says, hurry up and go to my father and say to him, thus says your son Joseph, God has made me Lord over all Egypt. Come down to me, do not tarry. You shall dwell in the land of Goshen, and you shall be near me, you and your children and your children's children, and your flocks, your herds, all that you have. There I will provide for you, for there are yet 5 years of famine to come, so that you and your household and all that you have do not come to poverty. And now your eyes see, and the eyes of my brother Benjamin see, that it is my mouth that speaks to you. You must tell my father of all my honor in Egypt and of all that you have seen. Hurry and bring my father down here. Then he fell upon his brother Benjamin's neck and wept, and Benjamin wept upon his neck, and he kissed all his brothers and wept upon them, and after that his brothers talked with him. That, my friends, is a picture of radical grace and love. Radical grace and love. It's one thing to say, I forgive you, but it's a whole other thing to love and to hug and to fall on the necks of the people who have stabbed you in the back. And you may not be to that point, but I don't want you to exclude, I don't want you to write off what I'm saying if you're not to that point yet. But pray that God would help you to see what it's like to give radical grace and love to people who don't deserve it. Because there's a truth that we talk about quite a bit here at Movement, and it's this simple fact. Jesus changes everything. Jesus changes everything. Either he changes everything or he doesn't. And why I say that is because you may say, well, I believe Jesus can save people from their sin. But then when somebody hurts you, you really wonder if they could ever be saved. And you wonder if they deserve to be saved. And you wonder if you could ever forgive. But if Jesus has changed you, then he's changing everything. And that means he's changing every part of you from the inside out if you'll allow him to. And he can help you learn to radically show grace and love to people who do not deserve it. But are you willing to allow him to do it? It's not simply about just simply forgiving. It's about a change in our hearts. It's about a change in our hearts. When we learn to let go of hate and anger, even when we don't have the opportunity to do it in person or face to face with the person who's wronged us, we are the ones who are set free from our pain and our torment. And then God can use it to heal others, can he? What we have to understand and wrap our brains around is the powerful truth that when we hold on to unforgiveness, it's not the other person we're hurting, it's ourselves. And we're giving them power continually over us, even if they don't even think about us. They don't even lose a moment's sleep. They don't even gloat. They don't even remember. But we give them too much power, and so we destroy our own lives. When we let go of hate and anger, even if we don't have the opportunity to do it in person, we're set free from our pain, and God can use it to heal other people. And Joseph gets another opportunity to share this radical grace, because a few years later, his father passes away there in Egypt. And automatically, his brothers start to think, uh-oh, now we get to see if this is real stuff. We get to see if he's genuine. We get to see if he's sincere in his forgiveness, or if that was just an act while Dad was alive. Now we'll see what happens. Maybe now he's going to exact his revenge, but Joseph saw the big picture. And that's what you and I need to get our brains wrapped around. We need to be able to look at the big picture of how we can forgive people, because he remembered how God turned his trouble into a testimony for God's glory. Look at Genesis chapter 50. Genesis chapter 50, beginning in verse 15. When Joseph's brothers saw their father was dead, they said, "It may be that Joseph will hate us and will pay back for all the evil that we did to him." So they sent a message to Joseph saying, "Your father gave this command before he died. Say to Joseph, please forgive the transgression of your brothers and their sin because they did evil to you. And now please forgive the transgression of the servants of the God of your father." Joseph wept when they spoke to him, and his brothers also came and fell down before him and said, "Behold, we are your servants." But Joseph said to them, "Do not fear." Who else says that many times in Scripture? God does through angels many times. "Do not fear. Do not be afraid." He says, "Do not fear, for am I in the place of God? As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good." But God. There it is again. He says, "You meant it for evil, but God meant it for good." God took it and he twisted it around and he flipped it. He changed it from the inside out, and you thought it would destroy me, but it was for your salvation that God brought me here. Not just my own, but for yours as well. So that many people should be kept alive as they are today. Verse 21. "So do not fear, I will provide for you and your little ones." Thus he comforted them and he spoke kindly to them. That phrase, and I want you to wrap your brains around it. I want you to hear it. I want you to soak it in. I want you to take it down into the very inside of who you are in your heart. What you meant, and stop for a second. I want you to picture the person that you have the hardest time forgiving. Now, you may not have anybody that you truly haven't forgiven, but there's still somebody that you struggle with picking back up that grudge every now and then again. But I want you to picture the person or the group of people that you have the hardest time forgiving, and I want you to do your very best. Close your eyes if you have to, and I want you to, even if you have to point at them, I want you to say this to them. What you meant for evil, God meant for good. What you meant for evil, God meant it for good. And you're probably going to have to say it 100 more times. But God can take your brokenness and he can turn it into a blessing. Do you believe that? Your mouth does. But maybe your brain struggles with it. If you're like me. God can take your brokenness and turn it into a blessing, because Jesus changes everything and he can do it. God can take your mess and turn it into a message. He can take your mess of a life, whether it was caused by you or caused by somebody else, and maybe you're the person you need to forgive because of the destruction you've made in your own life. Let it go. As Elsa, I think, is that the right one to say?
Yeah.
Let it go and forgive yourself, because God can take your mess and turn it into a message, and God can take your pain and turn it into power. He can turn it into power. He can give you the strength that you never thought you had when you learn to let go and forgive yourself, forgive other people who've hurt you and harmed you, and trust that He is able. And it all starts with forgiving those who wrong us. They don't deserve it, but guess what? It don't matter. They don't deserve it, and so if you waste your time and energy waiting for them to deserve it, and if you hold your breath, they're going to be out in about 30 seconds. Because if you're sitting here thinking, you don't know my pain, you don't know what I've been through, you don't know what they did to me, if that's what you're thinking, you're right. But Jesus does. Jesus knows your pain. He knows what they did to you. He knows better than you do what they did to you. He knows the broken parts in you that you don't even understand yet. He knows what they did to you. And when He was hanging on the cross, when He was hanging on the cross in all of His sinlessness, He was hanging on the cross for sins that He did not commit Himself. He was thinking about you and me. He was thinking about us. He was thinking about His friends that had forsaken Him, had turned their back on Him, and betrayed them. He was thinking about the Romans who had pierced Him, His hands and His feet, and ultimately would pierce His side. He was thinking about the Jews who stood there and mocked Him at His feet. And those people, you and I, and all those people combined, is who He looked to the Father and said, "Father, forgive them. They know not what they're doing." Praise God. He was thinking about all of us who have wronged Him and betrayed Him. So if anybody understands your pain, and anybody understands what it's like to try to forgive somebody that doesn't deserve it, it's Jesus. He said, "Father, forgive you and me, because they don't know what they're doing." If Jesus can forgive, so can you. Can every one of us. It's been said many times before, holding on to anger is like drinking poison and hoping the other person dies. It doesn't make sense, but many times we've done it, haven't we? Holding on to that anger, holding on to unforgiveness is like drinking poison and waiting for the other person to die. My question is this: who in here today, or who online, is waiting for someone else to die while you're slowly wasting away with unforgiveness? Who's letting it destroy you? It doesn't have to. It's time today for you to live. It's time today for you to live. Whoever you are, it's time for you to live today, to be free, to not let go of the unforgiveness, to forgive like Christ has forgiven you. Forgiveness. Now here's some important things real quick. Forgiveness doesn't minimize the damage or condone the behavior. You're not saying that what they did is not wrong. You're not saying it didn't hurt. You're not saying it didn't mess you up. Forgiveness doesn't need to be preceded by an apology. Because if you wait for that, you might not ever forgive. And you'll just keep drinking poison. It doesn't have to be preceded by an apology. Forgiveness is an act of will, not of emotion. If you're waiting for the right feelings to come along, you'll be waiting a long time. And so you need to choose to forgive. And then this one: forgiveness sets free the person who forgives. Because many people, as we said, and I'm going to say it one more time, many people who you will forgive have never lost a night's sleep over what they did to you. Some of them don't even know what they did to you. But you have been held in prison if you were unwilling to forgive them. And it's time for the people who are watching right here. It's time for myself. It's time for the people watching at home to truly live. You may never want to be reconciled to that person who's hurt you, but you may save the soul of someone else who needs to see your example of grace and truth and love.
Yes, sir.
And that's the most important thing. Who knows what it might do in that person who's wronged you? But there are other people who are watching you and need to see you live out a life of grace and truth and love and forgiveness. In the novel and in the movie Unbroken, you hear the story, you see the story of Louis Zamperini, a man who was shot down in World War II in the Pacific Ocean and was kept as a POW by the Japanese soldiers in a horrible, horrible camp. And he was mistreated because he had been a world-class Olympic athlete, and they wanted to break his spirit more than anybody else, because to them he represented America. And if they could break him, that was going to break everybody else in that camp. And so this guard named the Bird, they call him the Bird, tortured him horribly over and over and over and over and all but killed him. And many years when he was liberated, he came home and it was like he was still in prison. He was troubled with alcohol. He became an alcoholic. He abused his family. He did horrible things to his wife and his children, and he almost lost them all. But thankfully, he came in contact with the story of Jesus, and it began to change his life, and it restored his family life. And then what he had been doing was saving up his money to go back to Japan to kill the Bird. He was literally trying to save all of his money, not to go on a vacation, but so he could murder the man who had taken his life from him. But then when he came in contact with Jesus, instead of raising money to go do that, he decided he was going to go and forgive the people who had hurt him. And he went to a prison that was holding people who had committed war crimes, and many of the guards that were at the camp where he lived and was tortured were there. He went and he forgave as many as he could, face to face, with tears in his eyes. They couldn't believe it. And he wanted to forgive the Bird. He wanted to see the Bird. And he still was struggling with that one. But the Bird wouldn't see him. And then ultimately he learned that the Bird had committed suicide, taken his own life. And it says that he was overwhelmed with emotion when he found that news out. He was overwhelmed. He was overcome. He was just completely covered in emotion. And he was surprised, though, by what he felt, because it was not hatred that he felt. It was not relief. He felt compassion. That this man never got to know forgiveness, even though he had done horrible things to Louis. Because Louis realized that he had done horrible things to many people, and ultimately he had done horrible things to God and his relationship with God, and he had compassion. And so that is when Louis finally knew that he had truly discovered forgiveness and what it was like. And so maybe today you and I, you watching at home, need to understand what forgiveness truly is, because you need to be free. I need to be free. Who needs to be free today? Perhaps you yourself have not had God's forgiveness in your life. And the scripture is so beautifully simple in what it says. It says, if you believe that Jesus is the Christ and you're willing to turn away from your life of sin, hear me in this, it's not get your life perfect. It's just turn away and turn to God. Confess him as Lord and King. Say, God, you alone are going to be the Lord of my life. You meet him in baptism where he washes away your sin. He gives you his Holy Spirit, raises you up to a new life, and you can be free. Your sin no longer has claim over your life. Satan can no longer accuse you because you have been washed in the blood of the Lamb, and you are free and forgiven. If you need that today, come and let's talk about that. Let's make that happen. Because nothing else will make sense. You won't understand forgiveness. You won't be able to grasp forgiveness to share with anybody else if you yourself don't have it yet. But once you have that, maybe some of you are sitting here and you are drinking that poison, taking light shots, just waiting for that person to die. You don't have to be imprisoned by what they did to you anymore. You don't have to be named by what they called you behind your back or in front of your face or the way they betrayed you. You don't have to be owned and destroyed by that. You can live today and be free. But it won't happen until you let it go. It won't happen until you say those words, I forgive you. And then you say them again and again and again. Forgiveness is freedom. And Jesus changes everything. Let him start with you today. Give us strength when we cannot utter the words. Help us, Father, to know that
We can't wait for the right emotion, but we just need to make it our decision that we are going to forgive. Or we need to make the decision that we're going to surrender our lives to you so we can begin that process of sharing that forgiveness and grace with other people. But God, help us not to be cowardly or afraid, but to stand in your truth and your power and allow you to take our troubles and our torment and turn them into testimony. Help us, Father, to show grace and love to people who have wronged us and to the people who are watching on the sidelines who need to see it. Our children, help our next generation not to be destroyed by unforgiveness and pain and heartache, but learn that they can be free and free indeed in Jesus. Thank you, Father, for giving us grace when we didn't deserve it. And help us share that with other people. We pray these things in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
the things I want to remind you guys of is, I know how difficult it is when you're wrestling with something, when you got something that you feel like God is pushing you to let go of, or a decision you want to make. It's hard to just take that first step to talk to somebody else. And of course, we talk straight to God. We can, you know, we pray and God hears us, but also He gave us family to lean on and to talk with one another. And I know it's difficult to do. And so I just want you to know that we are here for you. There are more than just me that want to pray with you and talk with you, help you get through the steps. So if you got something on your heart today, please talk to somebody before you leave. If maybe you're afraid of just saying the words out loud, we've got connect cards there at the back. Stop, fill one out, just write your name, phone number, email, put it down, and we'll contact you, and we'll find out what we need to do to help you. If you're online, just simply send us a private message on Facebook. Don't allow yourself to leave with that conviction that you're wearing on you, because it will slip away quickly. Maybe now is the time that God's saying, look, it's time to be free. And so I just want to share that with you. That's always an opportunity, and we never, our invitations never close. There's always a time to reach out and be loved and to love. And so we just want to share that with you guys. I'm thankful for you guys. I'm glad you guys are here. Keep inviting your friends. I hope and pray, you know, things will continue to become even more normal. We're trying to do our best to keep everybody safe and healthy. If the kids, for the packets, there was a thing to make a, what's it called? Ocean in a bottle. You can stop by before you leave, and Miss Sherry will help you make one of those real quick. If you're here in person, all you kids, so you make that ocean in a bottle craft real simple, real quick, and you'll fix that before you leave. Don't forget about campfire worship coming up next Sunday night, 6 o'clock, and also the missions event. Stop by that missions table on the way out, learn more about that, and also if you need a mask, it'd be a good opportunity to just help bless missions as well. Let's pray, or we'll be dismissed. Father, we thank you for loving us more than we could ever, ever deserve. Your love is greater than our understanding, and I pray, Father, we take that understanding and that knowledge as much as we have of it, our love and forgiveness that you poured out on us, and we share with other people. Help us to be your church. Help us to be your hands and feet as we go out, God. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. See you later.